Please welcome on stage, Jordi Boggiano.
Thank you, and good morning. Just first, a little note of, because last time I drank a Sprite on stage, people in the back thought it was a beer, and then they commented later that, like, what the hell the speaker was drinking on stage. This is a Sprite, there's no alcohol. All right, so now that that's out of the way, yesterday morning I was kind of disappointed because, well, I'm not really from the NEOS like community, and I'm not really like up to speed with what's going on here. So when Robert he said that TypeScript was now called Fusion, and I was really disappointed because at home I have this book still, and like it's still in the packaging, as you can see. So I think I'm going to hold on to it now, and probably it's going to gain value at some point. I don't know. Anyway, yeah, so that shows you how much I know about the NEOS and type of stuff. Well, unfortunately, I mean, that's not what I'm here to talk about, but that's okay. I hope I can still bring you some insights. So who am I? I am the maintainer of Composer and Packagist, also Monologue and a bunch of other libraries. So what this means is just that I've been doing this for a while, and I think I have a lot of experience maintaining stuff, and doesn't make me anything special, but it just means I maybe have something I can pass on to you. And so what I want to do with this talk really is to kind of show you my perspective. Because I don't know, like, how many of you are like maintaining a repository of any kind? Okay, that's pretty good. I mean, that's maybe half of the audience. So that's good. Like, I hope I can teach you all something about, you know, how to deal better with that. And for the others, I hope I can also help you interact better with maintenance people, like maintainers. Because I think that's one of the big issues that we have, like, some people that just consume open source and don't really realize what it takes from the other side, and they don't interact always very nicely. And so, like, I hope I can bring everyone to be better open source citizens, let's say. Okay, so to get started, I just want to look at the lifetime of a project. So as I experienced it, at least with Composer, which is a fairly large-scale project, but I mean, I realize it doesn't apply to everything the same, but I think there's still some takeaways there. So at first, you have excitement. Again, like, depending on the scale of the project, it's going to be a different scale as well, but like back in the days, I don't know, like 5 years ago or something. So Composer is going to be 6 years old. Like the first commit is going to be 6 years old on Wednesday, I think. So next Wednesday. So it's been a while. So these were like in the first year, I would say. You know, people were like trying it out, and it wasn't really working yet, but they were still really excited about it. And that's all fine and fun. And then you get to this commodification phase where people get used to having that tool. And it's like, you know, electricity is a commodity, just push the button, light turns on. If light doesn't turn on, you get mad, right? Because it's not how it's supposed to be. And so there you get the same effect where people just suddenly, if it doesn't work exactly the way they expect it to, they start complaining. And it gets less fun, slowly. I mean, whatever, it's just 2 minutes, but hey. Then you get things like this, you know, the obvious adaptations of XKCD comics. I mean, that's just bound to happen, I guess, but that's okay. This one was also pretty cool, I think, just because it's hand-drawn and, like, you know, I like the that people take the time to to express their madness, and then like they then posted it on Twitter, and obviously they like these things are never really posted towards me, like they don't mention me or anything, but I just look at like Twitter searches and I see stuff like that popping up, and I mean now I can laugh about it, but it's not always funny when you see it. Like, I mean it's not just me, obviously. So at least it's nothing special with Composer. On the other hand, like there's a good side as well to having this big project that. You get these kind of, you know, silly accounts that suddenly start paying attention to your project, and like you're kind of part of the community. Like let's say the project is part of the community as a whole. So yeah, you get just funny tweets like that, or like this one advising you to type rmrf/ to get the latest features, and yeah, I mean, anyway, just silly things, but it's fun. Like it's ups and downs. And then finally you get to this maintenance stage, and that's like, you know, that's from, I don't know which point you get there exactly, but then that's it, that's the rest of the life of the project basically. It's just maintenance and you coasting in that stage. And that, so I have this chart, was like some website that's gone now, but that collected all the stats from GitHub, and it showed you like statistics about what you do and when and stuff. But what I find really interesting is in the bottom there, you see, so from my GitHub activity, what I do most is like this half on the right there is comments on issues. And then you have like the green is new issues, so that's also kind of just like writing content, right? Like not actually coding. And yeah, so like this pushes is really the only thing that's kind of coding. And that's like a tiny slice of the pie. And I think this really highlights like what maintenance is. It's not about coding and it's not glamorous. It's just a lot of politics and talking to people, right? Like it's a lot of interacting and support and stuff like that. So yeah, that's what it is. Now, yeah, I'd just like to go a bit further into this these aspects of maintenance and what it all means. So the first one is time. I don't know, like if I guess you're mostly working in agencies doing like content stuff here, so I'm fairly sure a lot of you had to compromise at some point because you had like some situations like that where the client wants this and they want to pay this, and then you have a problem. So, like open source, usually the budget is actually zero, so that you might see the problem to begin with, but then also the clients, they tend to want everything, like because any idea that someone has that maybe would fit in your library, well, probably you should really do it, like it's that's just how it is. So that's not extremely sustainable as it is. So this leads to a few issues. One is work-life balance, for sure. Like it's quite tough. You have things like I guess you're familiar with that. This GitHub like contribution graph that they show on your profile page. So that's like someone working for Mozilla, I think, who is basically, you know, paid to do open source, and that's awesome. That helps a lot with the work-life balance stuff. So you see like those are Monday to Fridays, and then the weekends they're like on top and the bottom line there, it's basically no contribution, like virtually nothing. That's pretty healthy, like, you know, weekend thing. And then you have this approach of like the burnout pattern, which is kind of funny, but also not really. Like, I mean, then I looked at mine. When I saw this, I was looking at my history, and I thought, like, okay, like 2013 was kind of all over the place, you know, and like there's no clear pattern because I don't know, I'm just messy, and I work at the weekends, and I work here and there, and then I'm gone for 3 days at the conference, and then, like, you know, it's just not really structured. And then there, I don't know if you spot the difference, but there's a massive 2 month gap there where I just said, I'm done. And like, I completely couldn't deal with this stuff anymore, and like GitHub emails and stuff, I was just, nope. And so, yeah, all of summer there, I was just, crashed and burned, kind of. And then like August was mostly holidays, and so that helped me recover a little bit. And after that, I kind of picked up slowly again. But it's just, you know, it's not the right way to do it, I think. So I would say, like, really learn to think about this. And I mean, yesterday over lunch, we were discussing this burnout stuff a little bit as well. If you ask around, like, I'm sure you know a bunch of people that have experienced some amount of burnout. Like, it's always different how the way it kind of presents itself with people, and you know, some are just gonna be depressed, some are gonna get angry at everything, and so I don't know exactly how to tell you, like, oh, you should, you know, if you see these signs. I don't know, but if you just feel miserable overall, maybe you should think about why. And like, because usually I find that like reading a bit about this stuff, it seems like it's rarely like inflicted by the environment. Like it's not often that it's your boss going like, you have to work more, and then like pushing you into the drain. Usually it's self-inflicted. It's like people that think they're passionate about stuff and they want to do more and more and more. And like with this, like with me, it's like open source. Yeah, I really like doing it. But then there's no boundary. There's no time restrictions really. And like you have this sense of responsibility and so on. You just build up on that and you go like, I don't know. Slowly it just drives you mad. So yeah, just think about this. From the other side, like, what can you do to just avoid wasting people's time? Because like those maintainers are like giving their time to you and to the community. So I think respecting that is kind of important. I would say like issues like this, it's kind of funny. It's someone saying, "Oh, the logo is like a conductor and not a composer," and we had many jokes about this. But at the same time, it's nonsense, right? Like it's just a waste of time. Like, so you can argue it was done as a joke and it's okay, but I don't know. Like it's a fine line, let's say. This one is definitely over the line for me. It's someone arguing that you should use the en dash instead of a hyphen in the license file between the 2 years in the license file. And they then have like, what is it, like 20 comments about this, discussing the merits of different types of hyphens and dashes and whatnot. And you go like, people, what are you doing? Like, this is just like complete waste of time. Now, I mean, if you have the time, great, but I think it's, maybe you could spend it on something more interesting. That's true. Yeah, I guess they ran out of other problems. After 15,000, they were like, okay, like, that's the only thing left to do in this project. Okay, maybe. That's another problem that I love, the people just writing plus one. And I mean, it got a little bit better now that GitHub added this thing where you can just like add a thumbs up to the issue. But it used to be really painful. Like you had issues with 30 of them, and this guy put it really well, I think. Like, how many programmers does it take to plus one a GitHub issue asking for someone else to screw in a light bulb? And I think I really like it because it shows the problem. Like, it's a lot of people saying, hey, yeah, yeah, I want this too. But I want someone else to do it. And like, why? Sometimes I'm like, I look at these and I see 20 people going plus one. I'm like, if 20 of you want it, why doesn't someone of you step up and actually do it? Because maybe I don't care and I don't want to do it. Like, it's, you know, this is not the normal situation, I think. When people are like, asking for free stuff, and like it's okay. I understand there are some amount of responsibilities when you're maintaining something in terms of bug fixes and so on, but when it's like a new feature or something, it's, you know, if you all want it so bad, then surely you maybe have time to spend on it as well, right? Yeah, another little thing, but just like going back and closing an issue if you actually manage to solve it yourself, and especially not writing just, actually I fixed it, but writing, I fixed it doing this, that's really helpful, because then the next person that Googles for it finds that issue, they don't just find like this one line saying, oh, I fixed it, and then they're like, oh, that, thanks. I'm sure you've found some of that sometime, like this happens to me all the time as well. Then one thing like that we worked on last few months to kind of try and afford us more time, because you know the famous time is money kind of saying. We worked on this packages.com, which is so packages.org is like the open source stuff, and now we launched this .com a few months ago to do basically private package hosting and mirroring of your open source stuff. So you can like install from us or from GitHub. So you get like a mirror URL. So if GitHub is down, you're not stuck, you can still deploy, stuff like that. So we have a few features there in terms of managing dependencies. I hope that helps. So we're selling that. So I don't wanna take more of the time with the sales pitch, but just saying like it's out there. I'd appreciate if you go have a look. And if you have questions, just come talk to me afterwards. Then pride is, that's a nice feeling, right? Pride, this is good. So we have things like this where Spotify tweeted that they're using Symfony and composer stuff and da da da, and that was cool. Like, you know, it's nice to see that you're making a difference somehow in the world. I mean, not that Spotify makes a big difference, but it's, you know, your stuff is being used by others to build things, and that's good. Like it's, I think that's definitely a good feeling, no matter at which scale it is, really. And you also, like, I think another good aspect is you bring pride to people. Like this guy saying that you know, his first open source pull request was accepted, and he says he's well chuffed, which is British for excited. but yeah, so that's good. Like it's basically just, you know, hitting this merge button. Like I made this guy really happy. That's nice. Like it's a nice power to have. To just make people happy with a green button. and then there's also like the kind of aspect of teaching and learning stuff. And like I personally learned a lot just dealing with people's issues and like fixing bugs sometimes of someone on some weird platform or some, you know, you just learn a lot of things. And in this case, it's like, yeah, just this random comment I did on a pull request, and the guy's like, oh, wow, I didn't know that. I'd just been doing it for 10 years the wrong way, kind of. And, you know, it's nothing big, but it's nice. Someone learned something. I learned something else while reviewing, and we're all learning stuff, so that's good. Then we have anger, which is not as nice. So I'll let you read it, because I probably can't read it out loud. But anyway, like this is just an angry Australian man. There were 7 tweets, I think. When I woke up, I had to cut some because it doesn't fit, but yeah, it just went on and on from there, and I thought, like, what? What the hell? Like, so you know, like, someone in Australia that tells you, like, why are you not answering me? And while you're sleeping, like, this is unacceptable. while at the same time insulting me and just questioning choices that don't matter because, like, Solr and Elasticsearch are built on the same technology anyway. Like, it's just, like, this is complete nonsense and whatever. To be honest, like, this doesn't even hurt because it's just silly. Like, it's going so far that you can't take it seriously.
Dear community, please go
Yeah, no, I mean, I'm not even playing that game. Like, it's sure, it would be one way, but you know, it's not really worth it to engage with people like that, I think. Sorry? Yeah, well, in a way, but the guy deleted his Twitter account actually in the meantime, so I don't know. this one hurts a little bit more though, because that was again like someone tweeting this photo, and I don't know if you see exactly what's going on, but this one is like a locomotive that went through a station. Like, it didn't stop on time. That's like 100 years ago or something. It just like destroyed the station basically. So like that's the image of the train wreck, and then they photoshopped this composer thing on it, and then they printed it, and then they did this other one as well, which is like, again, it took me a while to notice what it was. I thought it was this weird pineapple on it, but then it's actually a rope going around, and it's like a hangman composer. And like, you see that these people did that, and like they printed it and put it on the wall and wasted some fine stickers on it, and it's like, and then they took the photo and then posted it on Twitter. Like, there was a whole process. Like, they were really pissed off, and like, I don't know. So that hits a little bit closer, and then you go like, oh no, like it's just, you know, it's just not nice when you see stuff like that. But then again, I see other things, like this was from a post by Leonard Pottering, which is one of the systemd maintainers. I don't know if you're familiar with the whole controversy there, but they're not happy. Some people are not happy, and then some people go too far, like collecting bitcoins to hire a hitman for him and stuff like that. It's just, like, this is really messed up stuff. Like, it's just, I don't know. Like, this is going way too far, and so I'm glad I don't have to deal with things like this. But I want to use this as a point. Like, there was this quote somewhere, that the culture of any organization is shaped by the worst behavior the leader is willing to tolerate. And I think if you see that, I think there's some truth to it. And because usually you have, like, you know, leadership like kind of sets the tone in the community, and when you have like disrespectful people on top, like, you know, Linux and Mr. Torvalds is not really the most I don't know, diplomatic person, to say the least. Like, if you Google a bit, you'll quickly find posts of him like insulting people, and so you have this kind of like thing said from the top that goes, okay, like, this is in this community, it's okay to treat people like shit, and that just goes down and down and down, and then you have things like this happening, and that's just sad. So I think you have to be aware of this when you have a library or any kind of project, and I think it applies to any size, really. Like, no matter the size of the repository and the project and the community, the example you set has an impact, and every interaction you have online has an impact. And so I think that's really important on GitHub especially, but also on Twitter. And like, you see, you know, in some communities, people like having fights on Twitter, and like, oh, you guys suck. No, you guys suck more. And then, okay, cool. Like, what did we achieve today? But the problem is really when this happens at the top, then you have a lot of people that, you know, are following like the community leaders, and so even though you think you're just tweeting at this one person, maybe you have like 500 followers in common, and those 500 people see this bitch fight going on, and like, it's just not helping anything. Like, it just means that the community as a whole gets more negative and toxic. So just keep that in mind. There are options like this like code of conduct for open source projects and so on. Like, that might help to set the tone. You can use it, you cannot use it. That's up to you. But I think it's really about what you actually do. Like, your actions are definitely the most important. Because having a code of conduct and then like treating people like crap still, that doesn't work. Yeah, I kind of touched on that, but I think it's really important. Like, if you have someone hitting you with stupid comments, like, don't play the game. Just don't reply on the same tone, because it never helps. And like, just that's simple example, not too aggressive, you know, just saying, oh, the composer makes me so sad in so many ways. Like, it's not bad, it's not extremely insulting, but it also doesn't convey any information. So the first reaction always is like, you know, gut instinct. I mean, at least me, I guess a lot of people are the same. You read something like that, you just want to punch back and say, hey, like, screw you, because, you know, like, you make me sad. I don't know. So, like, that's the easy way. But if you just take 5 minutes, go breathe outside, and then come back and say, okay, like, you know, like, just asking, like, what are you trying to say here? Because there's no information. Then, actually, most of the time, you de-escalate the conversation to a level that then becomes a conversation and not just a shouting contest. And you get information out of it. And usually, like, people are unhappy, they actually have valuable input because they're not happy, so there's something that's not working for them. So maybe you can learn something from it instead of fighting. Yeah, similarly, like, when you get stuff like this, just ranting, and then at the end, I kind of find it interesting, saying, like, again, just because you wrote it in your free time doesn't mean you escape the criticism. And I find that a bit borderline, because I agree that, yeah, I wrote it in my free time, and I put it out there, and that means, yes, it's okay to criticize the code, and, you know, that's fair, I think. But, like, just yelling at me is abuse, is not criticism of the code. Like, there's a distinction there. And I don't need to take that. So, in that case, like, when we reach that point in the conversation and you clearly see that this person is not interested in debate, then, okay, I'm just, like, lock and move on. And they can keep raging behind their keyboard, like, I don't care. Like, just, you know, if you don't go down to their level, then you don't get mad. So thankfully, GitHub lets you lock those issues now, which is quite nice. Okay, so that was it for anger. I'm done. We have to go through it. I'm sorry. So misunderstandings. I think it's important to really like understand, and especially, you know, well, I guess most of you know that there are many non-native English speakers in the community. And we're all speaking English online, and like, you have people from all sorts of backgrounds and all sorts of, like, I mean, language is one thing, but there's also a culture, and you know, different cultures communicate in very different ways, and that sometimes makes it quite difficult to interact. On the other hand, you also have things like there where there's just no description provided. That does not help a lot, like someone not explaining at all. So I just asked, okay, like, what's the point here? Because I don't understand. Now, I could have merged it because it wasn't a big deal, but I also don't really want to merge it because it's not, I don't see the value. So just ask for clarification. If you're not sure, it doesn't hurt. Like, and if people don't answer or don't care enough to explain, then I don't care enough to merge the code. That's like, coding style, I think in general, try and respect the coding style, but I'm not one to say, like, oh, you know, you have one space missing there, so I'm not merging it. I don't think this achieves anything. Especially since you have tools that help with reformatting everything these days. I'm just like, if it looks somewhat like the appropriate coding style, I'm okay, I'll just merge it and fix it later, that's fine. But I think, like, from a, you know, I don't want to prevent people from contributing because of it, but I think it's still nicer, of course, if you like, keep this in mind and respect the coding style. On the other hand, like, stuff like this is just totally unacceptable. I think of, without like talking to us before, sending a pull request that changes the entire coding style of the project to follow this Airbnb syntax specification, which I never heard of, and I don't care. Like, it's just, I was like, what is this? Like, it just came out of nowhere. I think we never saw this guy before, never saw him after, and that's just, okay. And I mean, clearly I did not merge this, but I don't know, like this, I don't understand what goes on in people's minds sometimes. So another point is really like it's kind of connected, but it's if you want to do big changes, just ask ahead. Because in some cases, like in this, we had one example, you see it's like 60 commits and 800 lines of code. And like in the description, he was saying, well, you know, we have this new intern that just spent like the last 2 weeks on this, and it's like, it's nice, and da-da-da, and we're doing this and this and this. And then I look at it, I'm like, yeah, but I get what you're doing, but don't really want to merge it. Like, it's just a lot of code that it's, you know, I wasn't really comfortable with it. And then we had a discussion about like understanding what they were actually trying to do out of it. And like really in like 10 minutes and in 5 comments, they were like, oh yeah, okay, yeah, we could do it just that way, that's fine. And they don't need this anymore. And you're like, okay, if you could have talked 5 minutes to save those two weeks of work and saving me from feeling horrible from closing this because the guy worked for 2 weeks on it, it's like, that would have been win-win, I would say. So really, like, just don't be afraid to send an issue and say, hey, look, I'd like to do this. Does it make sense or not? And because, yeah, usually the maintainer has a clue about the project and they can help you. guilt is, that's a funny one, maybe. So I don't know if you know about this Bumblebee project, but there was a Ruby project, I think, that I think it was called Bumblebee. Like one day I just saw this on Hacker News, you know, top of Hacker News, with hundreds of people making fun of them because they had a typo and they had an RF script. And they put a slash, and then they put a space, and then they put a variable name. And because of the space, RM is very helpfully going like, okay, I'll remove slash, and I'll remove whatever is in the variable. And that's just like everyone updating to the latest version was just wiping their disk. And that was not fun. So you see stuff like that, and it makes you think a little bit, you know. And like one day I woke up, and I just saw this email in my inbox, and I'm like, oh man, this is like that was the image in my head. Like I'm like, this, that's it. I'm never working again. Like I'm done here. It turns out it was okay. Like nobody really noticed. And it was, to be honest, it was misused more than a bug in the code. But it was just, yeah. It still happened, like by using the project, someone still managed to wipe some stuff, which is not good. Like, this is not something you want to strive for, let's say. So communication, I think, is really important because down the line, it's all just humans doing stuff, right? Like, it's all about code, sure, but it's still humans. And like, I think GitHub was really amazing in like fostering open source and making it really easy to contribute and so on. But on the other hand, like it's very dehumanizing, I think, that you just have this button to merge, button to send pull request, button, and it's all very streamlined, but then it's, you know, you just don't need to talk to anyone anymore. And that's, it's good, I guess, most people like that. But I think like just when you merge something, saying thank you, it doesn't hurt. And actually I saw, I think last week, or like a few weeks ago, they added this thing where they put this badge on the user's line. They say like first time contributor, if it's the first time they send you a pull request to the project. And I think that really helps because, like, that's something I was trying to keep in mind. Like, okay, if I don't recognize that person, I'm just gonna try at least and say thank you at least once because, you know, it's like their first experience with this project, and that just puts the expectation and like it puts the mindset that okay, we're friendly people here. And like this helps because you clearly see, okay, that's the first time someone contributes something to your project. You probably wanna be a little bit nicer than you would otherwise. Like, it's just to welcome them in and not like say, hey, you know, that's not how we do it, you should know better. Like, no, come on. So yeah, just think about that. Another quick thing is, like, it's not about this, but it's really just about this easy pick tag here, this label that I'm using that on a few projects. I think it's helpful to have something that highlights stuff that's easy to get in. So it's like, usually I tag issues with that that I think are not extremely important, like they're not urgent to be fixed, but they're also pretty easy to fix probably if someone cares to do it. So that's a good entry point. If someone wants to contribute and they see this like easy pick tag, I don't know, like I guess other projects use other names, but I think that's a good way to get people in. Yeah, that's just, you know, another point about communicating properly, saying, do you have problems? I'm like, I don't know, do you? It's just sometimes I can't help. I can't help myself. I have to make fun of people. But so you see, like that was the problem. Okay, like then maybe, you know, if you sent the error line or something, then maybe we can help you. If you just say, do you have problems? We really can't help. Like, so yeah, just think back. Like, if you want to report an issue, really, like, say what is not going well and like why it's not going well, and just, you know, information. Always helps. Community, that's I think that's one of the best points, really, like for me at least. Like it includes stuff like conferences. I mean, like, I don't know about you, but like, I mean, as I mentioned, I am not from this community here, so I didn't really know anyone. I mean, apart from Robert, who invited me. So I don't know. Yesterday I probably met like 20 different people, and that's cool. Like, met a bunch of new people, friendly, all of them, I think. So no, this is good. Like, you have other good aspects. Like, I think this was for the third birthday. I got this cake in the mail. Like, this post box. The cake in it. I didn't know you could mail cake, but so that was cool. That was pretty funny. Like, some guy for Halloween dressed up as the composer logo, and like, if you look at it, it's really quite accurate. Like, down to the position of the fingers and everything. He tried really hard. So yeah, he showed me this. I think it was in Ukraine. I went to a conference there, and like, he came to me and like showed me the photo. I was like, okay, that's awesome. And last week there was this one, which I don't know. That was amazing. Like, so there was someone saying, like, you know, in case your computer overheats, you can cool it down with this thing. Like, and it's just, I mean, it's brilliant. Like, anyway. Sorry? I don't know exactly how it works, but yeah, it seems to work fine. And yeah, the little palm tree thing there, like, it's just priceless. Like, anyway, but this is like just cool stuff you get from the community, right? And just people having time and like spending it on not always the wisest things, maybe, but it's still fun. Then with contribution, I would say like small pull requests, they matter a lot because they're kind of the entry point, or like the, what do you call it, like gateway drug of open source, I would say. Like, it's easy if you make a small pull request, and you know, like, you don't have too much fear that, you know, maybe just a little fix to the documentation, whatever. Like, it's easy to get started, so you should really encourage that, I think. And then the people can build up to bigger things. On the other hand, it's important to know that there are no small pull requests. Like, as far as I'm concerned, there's nothing that's simple enough to just merge blindly, because like, when you think like that, just 1 out of 10 that you merge like that is gonna screw you. Like, it's, that's just how it is. These like simple fixes that you think, no way this breaks anything. Merge, boom, and then we have this thing, you know, where it builds automatically the snapshot, and then people start updating to the latest, and everything blows up. And so, like, this happens once and twice and three times, and then you start getting the cue that you should really not merge anything without trying it out, like, properly and thinking about it. So that's why sometimes, yeah, it takes time to get stuff merged, and people get slowly mad and like, anxious, but that's just how it is. Like, you know, it takes time. And on the other side, like, if you're scared of contributing, I think there's really nothing too small. Like, nothing is not valuable. Like, even if you fix a, you know, like, if there's a typo in the documentation, for example, that prevents, like, first-time users to, you know, they copy-paste this thing to try your library and it doesn't work because there's a typo, this sucks. Like, this breaks the first-time experience for all users. If you fix that typo, this is extremely valuable. Like, it can be anything, right? So don't be scared and just go for it. Yeah, it's also not just about code. Like, you have a lot of other things you can help with. And if you don't know what to do, I would say just try to stop ignoring problems and spot something that's just not going smoothly in your daily job, and see, okay, like, this. It's just not ideal. Maybe it could be done better. And then, like, if only, just go and report it and say, hey, look, I'm always doing that and it annoys me because X. And just by reporting the issue, you might trigger someone else to fix it and make your life easier. Or maybe they'll have a good idea and then you work on it. Or you have a good idea, you work on it, whatever. Like, it's just, I think that's a good way to find inspiration, is to see what's kind of disturbing you. So just to quickly sum up, so open source is really more than just like dumping code for free. You know, like, a lot of companies like to do that. It's just like, hey, here's open source. And then they never look back at the repo and there's issues piling up and stuff, and open source. So it's definitely more than that. And it's also more than just getting code for free. Like, I think that's also an approach that a lot of businesses like to take, which is, yeah, we get free stuff, cool. But I think it's all of this, like, open source, you have, and probably more, you know, but it's this whole thing of pull requests and feedback and like getting people to contribute, reporting issues, a lot of community work, which is like can be done by anyone as well. Like, really, actually, all of these, like, the only thing the maintainer can do that nobody else can is merging pull requests. Like, this is pushing code. Everything else, anyone can do it. You can just hop in any project and start helping and doing this stuff, and usually people are not gonna complain, I think. So yeah, just, like, to think back to everything I showed you, I think it definitely can be hard, and, like, yeah, I've had a lot of people coming to me after seeing this talk going like, yeah, this resonates a lot with me. And, like, sometimes I have this feeling of, like, you know, just ungrateful people just, like, complaining all the time, reporting issues and never contributing anything. And it can slowly bring you down. So if, like, again, thinking back to the burnout, like, please just don't, like, recognize it early and take a break, like, take it easy for a while, but don't let it go too far to the point where you just have to quit, because, like, I've seen that happen a few times. People just, like, from one day to the next, they're gone because they can't anymore, and usually they didn't enjoy that experience, and the community doesn't benefit either because someone has just vanished. So it's really not, like, a win for anyone. So yeah, just take a break, come back, maybe there's cake when you come back. And yeah, like, this one I think is pretty important. Just saying, like, you know, if you consume open source software, you should be nicer to those that produce it. And that's like that applies to me as well, right? Like it's not me preaching. Please be nice to me. It applies really to everyone, because I think it's all like this big open source machine, and I'm producing stuff, sure, but I'm also consuming a lot of open source, and so we're all consumers, and we're not all producers, sadly. But I think we should get more people involved, and I think everyone that uses things should be a bit more aware of this and a bit more ready to take part in the process as well. So that's it. Thank you.